Hi there, physics fans. How you doing? We've turned our attention from what we know to some of the more outlandish physics theories, ones that strain the meaning of science. Last week, we talked about the suggestion that our universe is a hologram. Can we top that? How about the claim that we're living in a simulation? That sounds like a great topic for this week's episode of Subatomic Stories. The idea that we aren't alive in the sense that we think we are, but rather all of us, indeed the entire universe, is merely a simulation, is a pretty outlandish proposal. You can be excused if you think that it might not even be science. But let's kind of dive into the idea and see where it takes us. The intellectual origins of the simulation hypothesis are pretty ancient, beginning in the musings of ancient Greek philosopher Anaxarchus, and they can also be found in some of the writings of Descartes. But the modern idea is usually traced to writings by Nick Bostrom, a distinguished philosophy professor at the University of Oxford. Bostrom's claims that we're living in a simulation goes something like this. He looks at the improvements in computer power that we've seen over the decades, and he projects that trend forward into the future. He believes that one day there will be sufficient computer capacity to simulate reality. Now, computer simulations aren't new. My colleagues and I do it all the time to calculate what will happen in our detectors. Meteorologists use simulations to predict the track of hurricanes, and the big stock trading companies use simulations to predict the market. This is all normal stuff. But Bostrom is talking bigger. He's talking about simulating bigger realities, our past, our present, and our futures. Want to know what would happen if you'd ask Sue Ellen Panofsky to the prom instead of that girl who broke your heart? Simulate it and find out. Maybe you'd have three kids and have started a company that made you millions. Want to know what would have happened if you got serious about playing poker competitively? The simulation could play that scenario out and you'd know the answer. In this future world, there will be sufficient computer capacity to simulate not one reality, but rather thousands, millions, billions. There could be countless simulations in which people are born and live and die, generation after generation, billions of them. If that's true, then Bostrom asks the question, if there are billions of simulations and only one organic reality, what are the chances that we're in the reality and not in the simulation? Going purely on statistics, he concluded that it's far more likely that our lives and dreams and loves are just one of the simulations and not a true reality. So that's the gist of his argument. Truthfully, it sounds kind of crazy to me, more science fiction than real fact. But that's philosophers for you. On the other hand, Bostrom is a distinguished professor at a distinguished institution. He's not some crazy guy shouting on the street corner. He's earned the respect of at least having the idea evaluated fairly. So let's start intellectually. Can we rule out the simulation idea on logical grounds? Probably not. Assuming that his claims about future computer power are valid, then his logic is good. Computer scientists can speak up as to whether they believe this level of capability is likely, but it's not outrageous, so let's give him that one. What about experimentally? Is there an experiment that can test the simulation idea? Well, yeah, I can think of a couple. Most of them arise from the fact that in computers, numbers don't have the infinite precision that they do in mathematics. Numbers are stored as bits, a series of switches that are either on or off. In our computers, individual numbers are encoded in arrays of 16 or 32 switches, what computer professionals call 16-bit or 32-bit numbers. And a 32-bit number, the smallest number that can be recorded, is 2 to the minus 126 power, which is about 1.175494350 times 10 to the minus 38 power. Now, if you're a computer wonk, you know that there are a variety of ways one can encode numbers using 32 switches, so this isn't unique. I just picked a scheme to illustrate that there is a smallest number. And if there is a smallest number, then it stands to reason that our simulated reality has the smallest bit of space and time. If that's the case, then measurements sensitive to quantized space-time are good ways to look for evidence for a simulation. One approach was followed by a research group here at Fermilab. They built a device called the holometer, which is a powerful laser array designed to look for quantized space. The experiment ran successfully, but found no evidence for a smallest bit of space. Then there are people studying the arrival time of light from gamma ray bursts, which are astronomical events that are the brightest thing in the universe since the Big Bang. They can be seen across more than half the cosmos. Some theories of quantized space predict that light of different wavelengths will have slightly different speeds due to quantum effects. These experiments have also failed to find quantized space. Indeed, there have been many experiments proposed to test the simulation hypothesis, all based on the idea that even in the future, computing resources will be limited in some way. None of the proposed tests have shown the slightest evidence for the simulation hypothesis. Now, absence of evidence isn't evidence of absence. It's possible that these hypothetical computer resources are larger than current measurements can test, so we haven't completely ruled out the idea of a simulated universe. But we've at least performed a few experiments to explore the idea with no evidence that it's real. The proposal of a simulated reality isn't exactly dead, but it's certainly on life support. Truth be known, I always thought the simulation hypothesis was always a bit of a stretch. Okay, more than a bit. I thought it was a big stretch. But my colleagues and I are in the business of trying to figure out the rules of the universe, and that means we need to test all ideas that aren't ruled out by experiment or logic. And that's where we are. The simulated universe is an open, if a bit sketchy, question. But you know what questions aren't sketchy? Yours. Let's see what you have for me this week. Question time is great. Let's jump into it. Romansky asks if there's dark antimatter. Hi, Romansky. Good question, for which there is no definitive answer. First, we don't know if dark matter is even real. All signs point to the answer being yes, but we've not discovered it yet. Second, if dark matter does exist, we don't know its properties. If it's like ordinary matter, then dark matter and antimatter would be created. On the other hand, dark matter and dark antimatter might be the same thing, like the photon, which is its own antiparticle. And with ordinary matter, there was some sort of asymmetry in the early universe that made the antimatter go away. That could have happened in dark matter, too. Bottom line? We don't know. I wish I knew the answer, but I don't. Karshard Boy asks if the discoveries at Fermilab or the LHC are classified or not. Hi, Harshard. Everything at both facilities is completely open. Well, except, of course, our time gate and the UFO we house. Those don't count. No, seriously, though. There is zero classified work done at Fermilab or CERN. Nobody here has security clearances, and all of our work is published in open journals. The only secret here is the cafeteria chef won't give me their recipe for their turkey chili, which is really, really good. Sean asks that he loves how camp I am. Thank you, thank you. It's my secret superpower. And to just get you thinking, imagine the jokes that don't make it to the final video. Our outtake reel is epic. Cuthbert J. Twilley wants to know if I have read all of these books and asks for a friend which of the books behind my head are my favorite. People have been asking about my books for a long time, and now is time to answer. First, yes, I have read every book I've bought, and certainly everything you see here. To answer the question you asked, if you start at the Cleopatra book and head over to the right, my favorite books are those over here. But then again, I wrote those, so. More seriously, my history books are organized by era, and the ones behind me run from classical Rome to the French Revolution. I like The Great Mortality by John Kelly. It's a tale of the Black Death of 1347. Morbid, but a good read. And over here, on your left, are a bunch of books written by Michael Grant. He writes history books about ancient Greece and Rome at the same level as I write about science. He's a good fit for an amateur history buff like me. And off here to the side, there are a lot of good books on physics. There's Daniel Steyer's book on relativity, which is excellent. Robert Crease's book, The Second Creation, is a fantastic version of the history of particle physics. And if you like physics but aren't into math, there's Lewis Carroll Epstein's Thinking Physics, which poses physics questions, and you're asked to figure out what happens in each situation. But truthfully, I love all of my books. Safdar Safdari asks how we know distant astronomical objects are real. Hi, Safdar. That's actually a philosophical question. How do we know that anything is real? We don't really. We just have to assume that our senses give us a reasonable, although imperfect, representation of the reality around us. I can't disprove that we're not living in the Matrix. On the other hand, there is no reason to think that we do live in the Matrix. I'm probably not Neo, and you're probably not Morpheus, and the universe out there is probably what it seems. I can't prove it, though. I be David 7 asks about mathematical equivalence and its relationship to reality. Hi, David. That's a tricky business. There are mathematical equivalences, like doing quantum mechanics using either linear algebra or with differential equations of what are called orthogonal functions. Those are mathematically equivalent and both work equally well. Picking one is simply a matter of taste. But the correspondence between theory and reality is trickier. For instance, a good map has a one-to-one correspondence to the location it represents, and you can use one to predict what happens on the other. But the correspondence fails at the edge of the map, highlighting the limitations of representing a reality with an abstraction. On the other hand, if the abstraction is a good representation of reality, you can use it to predict things you didn't already know. For instance, when Paul Dirac merged quantum mechanics and special relativity, the equations predicted antimatter, which we didn't know existed. Later measurements validated his prediction. On the third hand, his theory failed to predict the magnetic properties of electrons, meaning the correspondence was imperfect. The bottom line is that you should remember that reality is reality, abstractions are abstractions, and their correspondence is something that can often be useful but should always be used cautiously. And the fact that you can map a three-dimensional world onto two-dimensional mathematics doesn't mean that the world is actually two-dimensional. Beppe Minozzi asks if the CMB is the image of our entire universe, our visible universe, or something in between. Hi, Beppe. Technically, a tiny bit smaller than the total possible visible universe. In principle, if the universe is 13.7 billion years old and the universe isn't expanding, we could see a maximum of 13.7 billion light years away. Of course, the universe is expanding, but I'm ignoring that as a complication to the question. However, the early universe was very hot, and light was scattered in the hot plasma that existed at the time. In the beginning, the universe was opaque. It was only about 380,000 years after the Big Bang that the universe cooled enough to become transparent. The moment the universe turned transparent is what we see when we look at the CMB. It is when the universe was 0.003% its current age. So, in principle, the visible universe is a tiny bit bigger. The CMB is almost, but not quite, the sphere we could see if the early universe wasn't opaque. Jordi Guinart asks if the future of physics depends on an empirical discovery or a mental advance. Hi, Jordi. The answer is both. They go hand in hand. Thoughts without confirmation are often fiction. Observations without a mental framework are a curiosity. In the end, I would argue that the observations are the more important of the two, since they are what grounds one's ideas with reality. But you really need both. Okay, so now I have to change the topic. When we started the Subatomic series of stories, I promised to use it to tell an entire tale, to put together a series of videos that will let the viewer sample everything it is that we know about cosmology and particle physics. It is, admittedly, a very high-level treatment without a lot of details, but the 35 episodes, watched in order, will tell you an awful lot what we know about these fascinating topics. There is also a lot of questions and answers and a smattering of high-quality dad jokes. High quality. It's all good stuff. But it's also complete, so I'm sad to say that this is the last episode of Subatomic Stories. But don't worry, we're not going anywhere. We're going to retool and return early in 2021 with a new series of great physics. We hope to see you when we resume. In the meantime, we hope you enjoy the holidays. Watch some reruns of the many videos Ian and I have made over the years. I put URLs to playlists of both series of videos that we've made. That'll keep you busy. Please take this moment to subscribe to the channel, share on social media, and take a moment to recall the most important takeaway message of all of our videos, which is that, say it with me, even at home, physics is everything.